like that sailing song they started out with today. I think I saw you on the boat. You were laying out on the front of the boat. I don't know if you saw. Did you look carefully?
Yeah, that's me.
You know, this is going to be. I wish. No, I think I saw you out there.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Did you look real close?
No, I didn't. No.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to get up on the stool.
Well, it looks like we're back to our series, The Second Cup, and I thought we would finish up with questions that people have asked us.
Really? That's what we're doing?
No, I'm teasing. So, hey, I just want to say, first of all, I'm so glad to see all of you here today. Give yourself a round of applause. The Sunday after Easter is always an encouraging thing for a pastor to experience, because you wonder on Easter how many people are going to come back. And you're here today. Thank you. And those online, thank you for joining us today. We're glad that you're with us. Now, I just want to say a little bit about Easter. We had our largest attendance in-house that we've had, folks, in over a year. Isn't that great? In over a year. So encouraging. And I know many of you brought friends, and many of you had people here for the very first time. And I was so excited and am today that you're here. The second thing, which is the most important part of Easter, we know of 62 decisions that were made for Christ. That deserves an applause. There's nothing, Claudia, that thrills me anymore than when I see a person come to know Christ. And just standing up here last week, handing out the little stone with the cross on it, I had numerous people who said different things to me, but things like, today I accepted Christ. And there was one young boy, he was 9 years of age. And I told him, I said, you know, I was about your age when I made a decision to really follow Christ. And last Sunday was... the Sunday he made a decision to follow Jesus. And then I had a second young boy that was around 10. And he was up here, and he's standing up here. And he didn't know quite how to put it, but he said, I believe I'm being called into the ministry. Now you think of this, only 9 years of age. 9 years of age. And I remember back when I was just a kid feeling that in my own spirit. This was a super Sunday. And if you've looked on your program, you'll see how many people served last week. This is thrilling. And how many people were in our connection groups, small groups. And the offering was tremendous. So I just want to say, as pastor, back to you guys, thank you for all your work. Thank you for pulling out all the stops, inviting your friends. It was a great day. All right, so now we deserve another applause. Thank you. So next Sunday, I can't wait for Bill Clark to be here. Bill Clark, to me, is a walking legend. This guy used to be the CEO of Fisher. And he lived that life and that lifestyle. And many of you know the story where our son Clint kind of hit him up and said, So Bill, you're just going to spend the rest of your life with cars and building cars and so forth. What about doing something that will last eternally? And you know Clint, you know how he puts it. And this guy walked away from being CEO, flying around the world in his jet. And now he is doing everything that he can to put wells in Africa. And many of you are part of that team. And we're going to be celebrating that next week. So many of you, like I heard Jeff a while ago, is going to look for his running shoes. But be here next week, because this is going to be a big Sunday for us. And then we're going to move into another series moving up after that. All right. So I just want to begin by saying this. How much God has been working in our lives. I speak of Claudia and myself. And I just thought today would be a good day for us to share our journey. Now, I know I'm going to do most of the talking here, but I've said to Claudia, I've given her permission, like she needs it, to interrupt at any point and just say whatever is on her heart.
See, I didn't get
strapped with this kind of mic. I've got this one, so I can just jump whenever I want.
I don't know what that means.
I don't either.
Yeah.
I'm not really coherent right now.
You're not. Okay. So I'm going to go back to when I was a little kid, and I'm going to tell you about my spiritual journey and how God has led me throughout my life and how the Holy Spirit has moved and how the Holy Spirit has been very clear in decisions that I was to make. I was around 5 years of age. Now, I know you're going to see some pictures up here, and you're going to go, that picture doesn't fit the age of five. Well, what I did yesterday, I just went through the photo box and pulled some pictures and said, Mark, here we go. So this is the best I could do. But about 5 years of age, I do remember this very clearly. In Hamilton, Ohio, one of my dad's campaigns, I remember going forward, and that night, I gave my life to Christ. And my life has changed ever since that five-year-old experience. People say, you mean in Hip Town when those kids get saved, that's for real? I'm telling you, it's for real. And it was real in my life as much as I'm sitting here today telling you about it. And then some other things happened along the way. When I was about 10 years of age, I began to feel God's presence in my life, that you're to be a minister, Wes. And I really prayed that I would receive a calling. Now, I know everybody has a little different viewpoint on this, but I felt a very definite moving in my spirit that God had called me to be a minister. And so somewhere in that age of 10 to 12, I felt the call of God, and I made a kind of like an all-out commitment to Jesus. And then when I was 16, I was on a team that went to New Mexico to start two churches.
Isn't he good looking at 16? I really...
What'd you say, honey?
Go right ahead.
Oh, I want to hear you say that again.
Isn't he good looking?
She would say to you, but he can't hear worth a darn. So my first sermon was at age 16 in a little town, well, I guess not a little town, but Roswell, New Mexico. That was my very first experience. And there were probably 30, 40 people in the little building where we were at. And I remember our coach, Dr. McIntyre was our coach. And when we got finished, he said, I sure enjoyed your dad's sermon tonight. And it kind of shook me up for a moment. He said, that was your dad's sermon, wasn't it? I said, yeah, that was my dad's sermon. But he gave me permission. And I remember I preached on the prodigal son that night, and I invited people for the first time in my life to give their lives to Christ. One lady came forward. Now, she looked to be about 70, but as I think back, she probably was only 30. But in my mind, she looked like she was 70. That night, she gave her life to Christ. And I remember from then on, I thought, this is what God is calling me to do, is to call people to Jesus. For the rest of my life is to call people to Jesus. Well, I went away to a school called Indiana Wesleyan University. It was by a different name then, but we went to school there to study for the ministry. And along the way, I met this beautiful girl in high school, and I think I have her senior picture up here. I got to tell the story, and I wasn't going to. But she had just broke up with a star basketball player. And I knew, I said, Claudia, where is your senior picture at? Well, Bill has
Sweetheart,
it.
Sweetheart, they don't really
I got to tell the story, though. I've never been able to tell this story publicly. And so I got the address of her old boyfriend, and I went over to his house, knocked on the door. And I said, hey, Bill, I'd like to have Claudia's graduation picture. He looked at me like, are you nuts? I said, I'll just wait here on the porch until you get it. I did. I waited and I waited and I waited. I don't know what happened.
This is a guy I had dated for like 3 years, and we had a lot of pictures, and Wes wanted everything back for himself.
We wanted to break the old ties.
Oh, is that what we're
working
on?
Break the old ties.
Sure.
Break
sure.
it all.
You just didn't trust me breaking up with him.
So I led Claudia to Christ. I don't know if this is a good segue or not, But she said, where are you going to school? And I told her, and she said, well, that's where I'm going to go to school. She never heard of that school in her life, but she said, that's where I'm going to go. And so
I was already registered at another university.
Yeah, I know you were.
Dad had already paid for it.
But you saw the light.
Yeah.
So you go to this other school with Wes, and we had a long courtship of 12 months, and we got married. Isn't that long?
We don't advise that, but it sure worked out
for
us.
We sure talked against that with both of our sons. Whether they listen or not, I don't know. So while we were there, I get my first church, Epworth United Methodist Church. Little Methodist church in Bluffton, Indiana. And listen to this. We're both 19, and I got to tell you, we're green, right? Would you say?
We're green and good looking and thin. Look at that. This is what's wonderful.
I'll tell you what I noticed.
Reviewing your past.
When I see this picture, I see legs. That's what I see.
Wesley, that's why I didn't want to use it, because I knew you.
I know, but I'm married to you.
I know, but...
It's all legal.
It's personal.
It's all legal, because you're married to me. So
I don't understand his line of thinking whatsoever.
But well, if it was some other lady standing out there, there'd be some problems.
Oh, there wouldn't be. Hey, where did that come from?
I don't know, but you drew my attention.
We can take the picture down now.
Okay, we'll take the picture down. So while
he even lectured me when he found the picture yesterday. Boy, you wore your shirt short, and I said, but you liked it.
Oh, my.
I'm sorry.
I don't know where this is going.
I don't either.
We were moving in a very spiritual way here.
Okay, go.
Well, something happened while we were here. The Billy Graham organization approached me. Here I am, a kid, and said, we'd like to hire you. Now, I was shocked by all that, and I was enamored by that call. And I called my dad.
Tell them why they took note of you.
No. Mm-hmm. Well, you tell them.
He was the youth chairman for the Billy Graham Crusade.
Was in that area.
In that area. And he decided to have a walk. What do you want to call it?
A
march for Jesus. It was snowing, sleeting. It was 9 miles?
9.4, something
okay,
like that.
Okay, 9.5 miles. And to walk into the facility where the crusade is going to be held. How many kids did you have?
About 1,000.
Uh-huh. 1,000 kids showed up in this crappy weather, and we marched all the way into Bluffton.
For Jesus.
For Jesus. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yes. And so they took note of this young man.
They must have been hard up just to find somebody that could organize
that is
a march.
Not true.
But I called and told my dad. Immediately, my stock went up with my dad. He calls me back and said, Wes, would you like to work for me? Immediately, I'm very important to my dad. So so I couldn't say no to my dad. So I accepted this call to join my dad's ministry. And for 15 years, I traveled all over the world, 4 continents, 80-some...
240 nights a year. I just thought I'd throw that in there. Go ahead.
Okay, so 4 continents... 80 different campaigns all over the world, and I'm just trying to think of some other things. I trained over 10,000 people how to share their faith, 10,000, all over the country and various parts of the world. And yeah, that's right, yeah. So, yes, there was a big, some sacrifice with it for his family, but God worked in our lives, And it was a great time, 15 years of doing that. But toward the end of that period, I just felt the Lord was leading us. We just built this pretty house in North Carolina. But I felt the Lord was saying, you know, Wes, your first responsibility is your wife and your 2 sons. I mean, that's really what I felt. And I remember I resigned from my dad's ministry, a very difficult resignation, but I resigned. And I came up here and interviewed for a church plant. Now, that was sort of new to me and wasn't really in my vocabulary, but through our music director, his name is Marv Hollenbeck, Marv said, yeah, our church, Kentwood Community, is going to start a new church in this little town called, I think it's called Jenison. I remember looking in the atlas, and I couldn't find Jenison because the staple was right there, and you couldn't see it in the atlas. But I just took it by faith. And so we flew up here. Uh-huh. And long story short, we're here. We got the job. I didn't know there were 25, 26 uh-huh. other guys contending for it. But we got the job. Started Daybreak with 24 families out of Kentwood Community Church. They committed for 2 years, I believe. Mm-hmm. And we started down here at Sandy Hill Elementary School. And I had no idea how many people were going to come. But that morning, we prepared for 75. And at the last minute, we put up 25 more chairs. I don't know if Margaret Lamb is here or if Mary Merrill is here. Is Mary here? Margaret? Are either one of you? Okay. So I was in the school library with Margaret and Norm and Mary. Norm and Margaret, their team. Norm's gone on, graduated to heaven. But I heard this roar coming down the hall. And I know you're not supposed to really peek while you're praying, but I couldn't help it. I had to peek. And there are loads of chairs going by, loads of chairs. And I'm going, something's happening here. Either we're being evicted or there's something big happening. Well, that morning we had 327 people to show up. 327 people. October the 8th, 1989. And we didn't last there very long because there was no room.
That's right.
No room in the inn. So we stayed there about 6 months and then went to Jennison Junior High, and a great experience. And that's where we started moving out with, rear projected screens and lights on trees and all those kind of things. We just kind of like took a step up and started, doing a little bit more creative production. So Jennison Junior High, we lasted there, I think, a year and a half, maybe 2 years. Yeah. And then we went to the senior high in their auditorium. I remember that's where we hired Mark Courtney to come on. And Mr. Creative, I'm telling you,
he
Mr.
was
Creative.
So shy and timid.
So
yes.
I had a lot of wild and crazy dreams, but I didn't know how to put legs to them. But Mark did.
Yeah.
And always be grateful for him. So there's a moratorium, whether you knew it or not, with Jennison Public Schools. You can only be in there for about 5 years. And they told me that. And so I thought, we better find some land. And somebody said, you won't find land here. Farmers are not going to sell. And I remember I was driving up Baldwin here when it was just kind of a two-track road. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, there's your property right there. And there was no sign out here, nothing. And a lady showed up on a Wednesday night at our church. She was with Century 21.
Lisa.
Yeah, right. Good for you. How'd you remember that? I'm impressed. So Lisa said, what are you going to do for as a church building? I said, well, we're looking for property right now. And I found out she was a realtor, so it dropped a real big hint. She said, well, it's going to be tough. How many acres? All 30. She said, you won't find 5 acres. Called me 2 weeks later and said, at the corner of 36 and Baldwin, my owner has some land there, and he's already got 50 houses plotted, and he's planning to make this a residential area, but he would really like to see a church. And so this is where Daybreak, we got that land. We had no money, which has been usual, it seems like. We had no money. I don't know how we thought we were going to even do a down payment on
this. You don't even think that way.
But I said to the guy, yeah, we'll buy it. We'll buy it. And I was going to sign the land deed to Chris and everything else. I didn't know. Found out later, I can't sign a land deed. That's got to be done by somebody else. But this is the acreage that you're seated on here today. That was bought many, 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 many years ago. Well, this building, I think you can see some pictures here. It looked bigger and bigger and bigger to me as they were building. And I thought, oh, did we go too far on this?
Did you really think that?
No.
No. He was so excited.
You're just trying to keep me honest, aren't you?
No.
Yeah. So there were several things that happened during this period. Super Bowl party. Super Bowl party was unheard of. I thought, well, that's a good chance to reach out to another group of people. And we had a Super Bowl party that captured the local media, all three media, and then some. I remember the Moody network around the world. They heard about it. They picked up on it.
Yes.
And then ABC News heard about what we were doing here. And Peter Jennings, which I know probably means nothing to most of you, but he used to be a broadcaster with ABC News. They came in here and did a story. Yep. And 14 million people watched that night as Daybreak was featured as a church that was way out there in this farmland doing some pretty, they thought we were radical, doing some pretty radical church things. And that was that. That was pretty amazing. I just want to say this church has been amazing to me. You know, as I look at Hiptown, for example, and I think of what's going on there, and I think about the lives. I listened to Dave Beebe's story last week, and I thought about 20 years he's invested. This great football player invested in these young men to be world changers.
So faithful. Yeah.
That happens down here in Hiptown. Mm-hmm. And then down at the other end, I think about our whole student ministries team that runs that ministry. And today there's guys like Wally Harrison and Derek Barman and Clint Dupin. We just go through the list. Yes. Justin Wilchowski in Hollywood. These guys came out of student ministries and are making a profound difference and still are
for Jesus, all over
the country.
Yes.
And then I think about next Sunday. 75 wells, folks, in Africa today because of you guys, because of you. 225 mission projects over these 32 years. 5,539 of you over the years, add it all up, have been a part of some mission team.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to make a quick switch here. I've had the privilege on this stage to dedicate 635 little babies.
And kiss them.
And kiss each one of them. I don't do it now with all the COVID stuff, but sweet, sweet, sweet times.
Yes.
1,690 baptisms. Amazing. But the number that just overwhelms me every time when I think about this number, I get a spiritual rush. And we've kept records. And somebody said to me when I was sharing this just this week, they said, Wes, that number really does not indicate the true number. You have no idea the number of people that have never come forward, that have never indicated online, who have never in Fuel or Flood or Hiptown. They've gone home and asked their mom or their dad to pray with them. You've never had that experience in their life. Up front, 7,240 people have had their lives changed by Jesus through this church called Daybreak. 7,240. So I want to make a transition. About a year and a half ago, the Holy Spirit really began to speak in my heart. Really began to say, Wes, it's time for you to make a change in your life. And I don't feel real comfortable with conversations like this. And this morning is very difficult for Claudia and me. But we have felt God really speaking to our lives over a period now of a year and a half. You may recall when I asked Jeff Eckert to come on my teaching team here about a year and a half ago. And I was like, oh, totally relieved to have him once a month, once a series to help. And I was seated down here one Sunday morning, and the Holy Spirit just began to work on me and say, that's your next guy. Lord, what do you mean? That's not a verbal conversation. That's your successor. That's the person that is to follow you. I pushed it away. And then one day during a week or two after that, in my study back here, again, I felt the Holy Spirit speaking very, very strong to me. And I remember driving home and saying to Claudia, I've had an unusual experience today. I said, I just felt in my spirit that God has been speaking to me, that it's time that you make a change. I called my friend Ralph Bainham and I said, Ralph, he used to pastor up here at Spring Lake. I said, how does a man know or a woman know when it's time to make a change in their life? When they are to leave the church assignment that they're in. And here's what he said, a godly man, great friend of our family, served on my dad's board for years. And Ralph said, he said, Wes, you will know. You will wake up one day and there will be something inside of you that says, you will know. And that's exactly what happened to me. So about a year ago, I called Jeff Eckert and I said, Jeff, I need to meet with you. Now, Jeff is a very accomplished person in his own right. Here's a guy who started Never the Same Camps, who started
NTS and CYC.
CYC, which means? I'm asking Claudia because she's on their board, and she was a little slow there. I thought for a moment maybe she forgot she was on that board, but two great ministries. Organizations have sought after him, national organizations, if he would consider. And so when I met with Jeff, I thought, all of this is in front of Jeff. But if the Holy Spirit is speaking and this is a Holy Spirit thing, so be it. And so I met with Jeff, and he didn't really say much, and not much happened at that moment. He said, I'll pray about it, as Jeff often would say to me about anything that we would talk about. I'll pray about it. We met a few weeks later, and he said, my wife has always wanted to be a pastor's wife. I thought, I'm in. There's a crack in the wall. I went home and told Claudia about it, and I said, Claudia, you can't believe what I just experienced today. And so a few months ago, Jeff came back to me and said, Wes, I know I'm supposed to be here. I'm supposed to follow you. And so that's kind of the way this has all happened. Now, I want to give you a few questions that have already been asked by a few people. How did this all happen? Well, first of all, I met with the board, and we put together a succession plan through our board of elders almost 10 years ago. And back about Christmas time, I met with our board, and I explained what was going on in my life. And then they started the interview process with our regional superintendent, which I'm going to introduce to you in just a moment. So, one of the first questions, have I completed my calling here? And my answer is not complicated. Yes, it is. I know that my time here is finished. I know that. Have I given my best shot? I really believe that Claudia and I have given our very best that we had. I'm not bragging about it. Wes, is there some sort of a financial problem? Are you leaving because of the financial shape or whatever? No, not really. All these buildings are paid off, folks. 73 acres are all paid for. And we pay our bills. We pay them on time. Our church faithfully for 32 years has supported our world missions through our denomination, our universities, then our district, now our region. We've always fulfilled every year our obligations there. We're not in financial trouble. Now, I always ask for a little more because I know what we could do if a little more was given. But we're in great financial shape. Wes, are you just tired and frustrated? Maybe you need a few days off? Well, I'll just be honest with you. Every Monday, for 32 years, I felt like I was going to resign. But usually by Wednesday, things had pretty well patched up and I'd go after it again. Yeah, you get tired, you get frustrated. Is there a bad relationship that has stolen your passion? Let me just be honest and say there's always a person or two that rejects the teaching maybe that you're trying to give the church. And I've tried to practice Romans 12, 17 through the church here throughout these 32 years. I'll just put it up here on the screen because it's been an important verse for me when I have somebody that doesn't like something that I've taught in a message. And I've had a few people just get up and walk out. They don't like what I feel is God's truth, not Wes's. But Romans says, never pay back evil for evil. Do things in such a way that everyone can see you're honorable. Do all you can to live in peace with everyone. And that's sort of been my underlining theme as I have led this church. And so, no, I don't on purpose seek out people. Yeah, some people, you know, along the way, they don't like the direction. I've had people say, I don't like your mission. I don't like your vision. I don't like the direction. One of the other questions that I'm that I'm occasionally asked, and I think we're putting these questions up here so you can see the questions that we're using today. Is there a succession plan? Yes, there is. And you've heard it in a moment. Reverend Chris Conrad is going to join me on the stage. So what do you feel God is saying to you today? I feel like God is saying, Wes, you and Claudia are finished now, and you need to hand the baton over to Jeff. And so I'm going to invite you, Chris. Let's welcome Chris Conrad, who is our regional superintendent, huge responsibility, scores of churches. One other question that I am asked, Wes, what's your future plans? Just hanging out with Claudia is part of my future plan. And I'm being honest there. We're going to get some rest. But we feel, you know, we've done 50 years of ministry. And this summer we're going to celebrate 50 years of marital bliss. So I know some people think we look like we're 25 or 30. But these soles are pretty old. These shoes are pretty old. And we know now it's time to hand that baton. And I just want to say how much we love the people that God has allowed us to lead and to pastor these 32 years. Quite a few years. But I want to give it to you because I know you want to say some things.
Yeah, so there are a couple of things I want to say. And first of all, you said it, Wes, remind me. And how many people were watching the Peter Jennings In the Name of God? Did you say
14 million?
14 million. So as you guys might have remembered, if you've had to put up with a message by me before, I was one of those 14 million sitting in a little town in South Dakota. And we had just planted a church, my wife and I. And I had heard about this amazing church in Michigan that was doing incredible things. And our heart was just like your pastor and Claudia's heart. We just desperately wanted to see people open up their heart to a relationship with Jesus Christ. And I thought, wow, there's a couple out there. They're even more radical than Mary and I are. And I'll never forget, those of you who've gotten to know Pastor Wes a little bit, you'll understand that how I'm about to describe it is exactly how this went down. That Wes and I and our wives happened to be at this gathering of church planters in Orlando, Florida. And I'd never met Pastor Wes before, but I knew who he was from that special. And I walked up to him, and I was just a punk kid. And I walked up to him, and I said, Wes Dupin, you don't know me from anybody. I think I said, literally, you don't know me from Adam. But I just want to thank you. And he looked at me like he does, you know, huh? Like, who? And he literally said to me, who are you? It's literally what he said to me. And I said, it doesn't really matter who I am. I said, my wife and I have planted a church. And I said, can I just say, Wes, you have taken the hits in our denomination so that people like I don't have to. You've been on the front lines and have taken hits from people that are wondering why in the world are you doing the kinds of things that you're doing so that people like I can come and follow people like you. And I just want to say thank you to you for all that you've done. So not only did Pastor Wes and Claudia do an amazing job here, but they allowed literally hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people to come and to plant churches all over the country and say, I can get away with that because Wes and Claudia got away with it. And we didn't get beat up on because he already did get beat up on. And, you know, I do want to say just a couple of things. And that is that to go from that punk kid who was planning that church in South Dakota to now have the privilege of standing here on a Sunday like this, I don't deserve this. But I know this much. I know that 1 Thessalonians in the New Testament Bible says this. It's not on the screen. It's not Mark's fault. It's mine. But this is what the Message paraphrase of the Bible says. And now, friends, we ask you to honor those leaders who worked so hard for you, who have been given the responsibility of urging and guiding you along in your obedience. And I love how Eugene Peterson wrote this. Overwhelm them with appreciation and love. And we are entering a season right now over the next few months. And although they didn't say it, I'll share with you that their last Sunday as the pastors here of Daybreak is June 27th. So we've got a few months, praise be to God. It's not over today, okay? We've got a few months. But I think it would be appropriate for us, even this morning, on April 11th, just to overwhelm them for just a moment with our sense of appreciation and love. Can we do that? Can we just thank them for who they are and for what they're like? Thank you for doing that, and you can be seated. We'll have many more opportunities to thank them and to celebrate them in the months ahead, and I'm excited about that, and I'm really, really appreciative of them and who they are. Let me just make it really, really clear. I'm just going to be really personal for a moment, and that is just that this is hard for them because they've given their heart and their soul to this, and you know, I had the opportunity to arrange a sabbatical for them a couple years ago because they'd never had one. And to go for that long and not actually have an extended break just speaks of their dedication and commitment to this place. And one of my all-time favorite stories that probably won't get told after today in a public setting like this is when Claudia talks about, we were just talking down here about when they moved here, trying to find a house to rent and then eventually live in. And one of their houses, I'll never forget this, Claudia and I have laughed about this because she told me the story about how they had a pipe wrench that would turn on and off their water in the shower. And they couldn't afford to get it fixed. No lie. So, you know, just the things that they've sacrificed in order for us to experience everything that, you know, we come in here and it's all air conditioned or heated and it's all nice and we have very comfortable chairs to sit in and we just think it always was this way. Well, no. It's been because of the sacrifice of many of you financially, but it started with them. And so I just celebrate the sacrifice that they have made so that we could all enjoy. But this is tough for them. And I'll tell you, it's easily as tough for Claudia as it is for Wes. Because she loves her husband. There's the song, Stand By Your Man. I'm not sure I've ever met a better testimony of someone who stands by her man than Wes. Than Claudia does for Wes.
Thank you for clearing that up.
You're doing a good job.
You know, what's funny is that I'm not afraid of Wes. I'm much more afraid of Claudia because she'll let me have it, you know, in Jesus' name. And so, but she stands by her man. I just think, you know, she stood here so faithfully. And so, you know, she didn't get any sleep last night. Wes got a couple of hours. This is a tough Sunday for them, because they've given so much of their heart and soul to you, and those of you who are aligned, who call Daybreak your home church. Let me talk to you for just a moment now about the process, okay? I'll tell you, this is the most, in my 10 and a half years of having been, and I know some of you are not going to hear what I say at all. That's okay. There's a letter I think that's going to go out. The reason you're not going to hear what I say is because you're much more concerned about them, and that's great. You should be. This is a morning to be concerned about them. But the process, I'll just say, it's been unlike any process I've ever been part of in the last 10 and a half years. I literally got a text. This is how it went. Pastor Wes texts me, and he says, Chris, I think I'm done at Daybreak. I've already got my successor. Why don't you and I meet? Yeah. That's not the way it's supposed to go. But with Wes, so what else is new? I mean, this is just far for the course. And so we got together and we met in his office, and I'm just thinking, oh Lord Jesus, please, who's he going to tell me? What's the name? And then he gave me the name of Jeff Eckert, and I couldn't have been any more thrilled.
Yeah.
I've had the privilege of knowing Jeff for over a decade. I love him dearly. I describe him this way. Jeff is in our region. He's been part of our region ever since I've been here, running Never the Same and Claim Your Campus. And Jeff and Ariana are watching right now online. And you know, this is often how I talk about Jeff. Whenever we have a pastor's gathering, There are some people that walk in the room and want to be recognized and noticed.
Yeah.
When Jeff walks in the room, he is immediately respected just because of the integrity of who he is.
That's right.
That is true.
Jeff is a man of deep integrity, of deep prayer. Yes. He's a man of God. Mm-hmm. And I'm a huge fan of Jeff Eckert. Mm-hmm. So when Wes told me that, I just thought, ah, praise be to God. This is great news. Wes, not only did you marry over your head, but you succeeded over your head. Way to go. Way to go. So,
whoa.
Yeah. And
no, I didn't know that.
But can I also tell you something that I just thought was really, really meaningful? Wes told me on that day that he and I were meeting in his office. He said, now, Chris, Jeff is going to take Daybreak in some new directions. He's going to change Daybreak. And then this is what he said. And that's okay, because it needs to change. It needs to be who God wants it to be in the future. That is a man of spiritual and emotional maturity. See, some people would say, it better stay the same. Yeah. Not Pastor Wes, not Claudia. What does God have for this place in the future? So really, really, just as specifically brass tacks as I can be. This isn't actually, right now, is my only official thing I'm going to do this morning. And it's right here and now. Officially, 2 weeks from this morning, Pastor Jeff will be speaking here at Daybreak, as he normally does. But that Sunday is going to be a little different in that after each of the two services, you are going to have the opportunity to vote on Pastor Jeff to be the next senior pastor here of Daybreak. Everyone will be allowed to vote, but only the members' votes are binding. But I will tell you that as someone who comes in, who candidates someplace, you want to know how everyone votes. But only the members' votes will be binding. Now, if you happen to be already planning to be out of town on the 27th, or because of COVID, if you're watching online, but you're a member of Daybreak, the office here at Daybreak can arrange for you to have an absentee ballot. And so we'll be in touch with you about that as well over the next couple of weeks. If you're a member here at Daybreak and you want to vote, you can. Those votes will all be tallied on that day, April 25th, after the service. And sometime after that, we will let you know the outcome of that vote. Okay? And I'll tell you that the board did interview Pastor Jeff and Ariana. I was in the room. They did their due diligence, man. They asked the hard questions, and they left no rock unturned. And they said, well, it's great, Wes, that you feel that way. We want to feel that way. And they did an absolute job. And here's what they really prayed. What they really prayed that night is, Holy Spirit, would you allow us to sense your presence in this room during this interview time? And I'll just tell you, as I sat in that room that was just about 2 miles down the road, that's exactly what happened. Holy Spirit came down on that room during that interview process, and it was so obvious that this is God's anointed person for the future of Daybreak. It was a beautiful thing. It was just a beautiful thing. So speaking of the board, I want to invite the board up now, and we're actually going to ask Steve, who's been here for so many years, and you all know, we're going to ask Steve if he wouldn't mind praying. I want to ask you, if you wouldn't mind, to clap and thank the board for all the work that they do and have been doing. So again, you'll hear plenty more about, you know, the celebration we're going to have about Wes and Claudia's ministry and their party. You'll hear plenty more about that. You won't be ignorant about it. But 2 weeks from today, on April 25th, Pastor Jeff will be speaking here at Daybreak. And after each of those services, you'll have a chance to vote. Again, everyone can vote. Only the members' votes are binding. Okay? So that's all I needed to say about that. Steve, would you pray for them?
Absolutely. Lord and Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day. And I know these guys they have a burden for the Daybreak. And so do we. And I know all of our congregation does too. And we just take today and we lift these guys up to you. And I know it's a tough day, but it's a time and you plant it on their heart, it's time. And Lord, as we take these next steps as a church, we love you and want to be just doing what you want us to do. Be with them, protect them. I pray for the transition. I pray for all of us here in this room and online. Just give us a great attitude about it and be encouraging. And Lord, I just can't wait to see what you have in store for all of us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Now, there's one final thing that I want to say, and then I'll turn it over to Pastor Wes. If you have sat here this morning or watched online and said, okay, I understand this news. What does this have to do with me? Can I just encourage you with the fact that the Holy Spirit still guides and directs and leads us? And that Holy Spirit, the Heavenly Father, your Heavenly Father, is every bit as much in love with you and wants to guide and direct you, just as he has done Wes and Claudia all these years, just as he has done with Jeff and Ariana. He wants to guide and direct you. He has specific plans for your life that he wants to continue. It doesn't matter how old you are. By the way, I don't think Wes and Claudia are retiring. I think they're just going to re-enlist. And God loves them, and I have a wonderful plan for their life after daybreak. So we'll figure that out. But here's the thing. God's not done with you. God's got stuff he wants to do in your life. So don't let this just be a spectator morning. Allow the Heavenly Father to speak to you this morning, whatever age, whatever stage of life you're in, and say, I'm inviting you into the things I have for you going into the future. And their plans to give you a future and a hope and to bring you great joy. Okay? Any parting words? Are you done?
No, we're going to feature the band. They've got a special song.
They've got a great song. You're going
to
love this.
That they've dedicated to Claudia. And then I'll come back up and dismiss. So we'll yeah.
That you're traveling on, but there's one day here and the next day's gone. Sometimes you bend, sometimes you stand, sometimes you turn your back to the wind. It's a world outside every darkened door. The blues won't harm you anymore. The brave are free and the lovers soar. Come ride with me to a distant shore. We won't hesitate to break down the garden gate.
I bet you no church in the world has done life as a highway after the pastor just resigned. Only at daybreak. So could we do it one more time as they're exiting? And I'm just going to sit down here and listen to you guys again. But wait a minute. I want to thank our board of elders for the great job that they have done in this transition. This is many, many meetings. Thank you. And then I want to thank Chris Conrad. Big responsibility. As he's worked with our elders, worked with Claudia and myself, worked with our church. And then I want to thank all of you guys. Daybreak is you. This is Daybreak. Thank you. Thank you that couldn't be with us today. And it's probably a shock. I don't know. Next week, Jeff and Ariana will be here. And it's going to be a greet and meet in the lounge. So some of you have never met them. So you'll have that opportunity. And then as Chris explained, the next week, he's speaking and then we vote. And we move on from there. So thank you guys for being here today on maybe a tough Sunday, but thank you for being here. You've honored us by your presence, both online as well as here today. God bless you. Band, take us out on this.